Start.
Yes, sir.
I can hear you.
Good morning, sir. Good morning, sir. I am going to present a case of varicose vein. My patient, Mr. X, a 63-year-old male, Hindu in religion, and who is a shopkeeper by occupation, resident of Howrah. He is being examined on 6th May 2020. He presented with swelling of veins along the medial aspect of the left leg and thigh for 5 months, pain along the swelling for 2 months, and blackish pigmentation over the medial aspect of left ankle for 1 month. Now coming to the history of present illness, my patient was apparently symptomless 5 months back when he noticed swelling of veins in the left lower limb. The swelling was insidious in onset. It started in the medial ankle region and gradually progressed upwards and now extends up to the medial aspect of upper thigh. The swelling gets aggravated on walking or standing and almost disappears on lying down. The patient also developed dull aching pain along the veins. For last 2 months, the pain worsens towards the end of the day and gradually relieves at night. He also noticed blackish pigmentation around the medial malleolus region of the left leg since last 1 month. It is gradually increasing in with time. Coming to the negative history, no history of any lump in the abdomen or any pain abdomen, no history of constipation, no history of ulcer in the foot, no comorbidities like diabetes, hypertension, or ischemic heart disease, no history of breathlessness, chest pain, hemoptysis, no history of intermittent claudication, no history of painful swelling in the calves. Now, history of past illness, the patient has no history of pain or and swelling in the calf and no history of prolonged immobilization in bed or no history of any previous hospitalization. Now, personal history, the patient is a non-smoker, bowel, bladder, habits, sleep, appetite, all normal. Patient is on a mixed diet. He is a shopkeeper by profession, which involves prolonged standing throughout the day. Family history, the patient does not have any similar history in the family. Treatment history, no history of use of elastic stockings, no history of any injection treatment to the veins, and the patient gives history of homeopathic treatment, which he received 2 months back. No history of any allergy to any known food or medication. Sir, history is done.
Wait, Dr. Ugal Ramchak. We can have some discussion on his presentation on history.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, Dr. Hotchat. We'll have some discussion on the history.
Hello. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Hello, sir.
Can you? Yes. So finally, what are the clinical manifestations on which you are saying that this is the case of varicosity, and what is your final clinical diagnosis? Final clinical diagnosis.
Yes, sir. Based on the
Hello?
History. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes.
Based on the history, the patient is complaining of swelling of veins along the medial aspect of his lower limb. That is, it started from the ankle region and the lower part of leg, and gradually it ascended upwards, involved the leg compartment, and after that it also ascended upwards and ultimately involved up to the upper thigh, along the medial aspect.
Would you call it swelling of the legs, or would you call it swelling of the legs or swelling of the veins?
Swelling of the
patient can often refer the swelling for swelling of the seed of food, swelling of the yes.
Yes, sir. Swelling of the veins along the medial aspect. And sir,
yes.
The patient is also complaining of pain along the veins, which aggravates at night.
Along the veins, and complaining of pain along the veins, along the line of the veins.
Yes, sir.
Or over some areas like the calf or something like that. A vague feeling of tiredness or aching sensation. What is that?
Sir, pain.
Hello?
Patient complaining of pain along the veins, sir.
Shoman, come back to your history of illness slide. Come back to your slide. History of illness slide. Come back to the slide. First slide of history. Yes. The question Dr. Bhattacharya is asking, try to understand. Patient is very, very, very
actually, I can't see the slide. Only
try to understand. Patient is varicose vein, may have pain, yes. And that pain may be because of the stretching of the vein when the distension is very massive. But more common cause of pain is the aching sensation in the leg, which occurs in the cuff more towards the end of the day. It is not always the pain along the course. And you started the statement that patient also developed dull aching pain. Last day also I say, there is nothing called patient developing pain. Whenever patient has got a pain, patient experienced pain or patient felt pain. Okay, it's not that patient developed pain. So this English is not right. So try to understand and make a very clear statement whether this is just a pain along the course of the way, or you say some form of aching or discomfort in the cuff or in the thigh region at the end of the day when he walks for the whole day. That is the next part. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So, what are the other clinical manifestations related to varicocele that you have observed in this particular case? Or in other words, what are the different signs that you can expect in the case of varicocele? First, tell me what are the different signs that can be seen in the case of varicocele, and what are the typical findings you have observed in this particular case?
Sir, I have discussed those in the examination part, sir. In the history, yes. The patient is complaining also there is a deposition of pigments yes. around the medial malleolus of his left leg.
Yes. Why is the pigmentation occurring in the varicose vein? How do you explain?
Sir, in the varicose vein, due to accumulation of blood in the superficial veins of lower limb, there is venous hypertension. And due to the venous hypertension, there is inflammation within the lumen of the vein, due to which there is increased permeability of the veins. The capillary becomes leaky, through which the RBCs escape into the tissue plane, and those escape RBCs lies to form hemosiderin. And those hemosiderins give rise to the pigmentation, sir.
Yes. Okay, I think you can go to the examination part. Okay. Shoman, you will complete the examination part.
Okay, sir.
Yes, yes. Go on to your examination. Tell me what are the details in your examination. Yes.
Yes, sir. First, I will do the general survey, sir. The patient is conscious, alert, and cooperative with respect to time, place, or person. The build of the patient is average. Face is normal. Gait is also normal. Hydration status, well hydrated. Nutrition, well nourished. Pallor clubbing, cyanosis, icterus, edema. Pallor clubbing, cyanosis, icterus. Is absent, but there is mild pitting edema of the left leg. Neck veins not inwards, neck glands not palpable. Pulse 74 beats per minute, BP 130 by 70 millimeter mercury, respiratory rate 16 per minute, SpO2 98% in room air, temperature 98.4 degree Fahrenheit. There is no obvious deformity. Pigmentation can be seen in the left medial malleolus region, height 1.65 meter, weight 72 kg and BMI is 26.44. And coming to the loco-regional examination, sir, the patient is mainly examined in the standing position, and for few tests, the patient may need to lie down on a bed, and the normal limb is examined first, followed by the affected limb, and with 360 degree view of the limb. The right limb is examined first. It is normal. No abnormality was detected. And coming to the left lower limb, attitude of the left lower limb normal. No obvious deformity, no local gigantism. A large venous trunk is visible in the medial side of the leg, starting from in front of medial malleolus to the medial side of the knee and upwards along the medial side of the thigh up to saphenous opening. Skin of the leg, pigmentation noted around the medial malleolus, no ulcer or scar is seen, no loss of hair in toes or increased brittleness of toenails, and there is pop impulse of in the saphenous opening, which is visible. Palpation, Brody Trendelenburg test, it shows incompetence of both saphenofemoral junction and perforators. Multiple tourniquet test, it shows that there is incompetence in the below knee perforator. Fagan's test, it shows crescentic gap found 5 cm below the knee crease along the great saphenous vein. Swartz test was positive. Morris's test was positive. I did not do the Parches test, sir. Bilateral inguinal lymph nodes not palpable. Movement of the ankle joint was normal. Anterior tibial, posterior tibial, and dorsalis pedis artery normal on both sides. Auscultation, no Brouillard. Now coming to systemic examination, I first examined his abdomen. Abdomen was soft.
Wait. Have you examined the trunk as well? Bearing the trunk, have you examined the trunk?
Yes, sir.
Or the lower abdomen? Have you told that you have inspected the trunk as well? And what is the importance of observing the trunk as well?
Sir,
can there be varicosity as well over the trunk?
Yes, sir.
How would you explain that?
The superficial epigastric artery and superficial
when does it occur? If it is a common iliac thrombosis, common iliac occlusion, yes. If there is obstructive feature in the common iliac or the inferior vena cava, then there might be this kind of varicosity over the trunk as well, communicating the inferior vena cava system to the superior vena cava system. So you have to see the trunk as well. And you have examined the lower abdomen as well, na?
Yes, sir.
One more point. Have you examined the pulses in the lower extremity? Do you think that this is also important to examine the pulse in the lower extremity?
Yes, sir. I have checked the peripheral pulses in the lower extremity.
What are the importance of observing the pulse in the lower extremity in a case of varicosity?
Sir, patient is complaining of pain in lower limb. So I have to exclude the peripheral arterial disease in which the arteries will be...
How does it help in the case of pure varicosity with say some complications out of it? How does it help to note for the pulse? This is because if you want to go for a compressive therapy, pulse is very important. In a compromised situation, when the pulse is, you are not getting properly the pulse, certainly you have to think in some other ways, because compression therapy may not be applicable in those situations. Okay? And okay, hello, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
And secondly, yes, the ulcer is on the media. There can be a venous ulcer, but you have to differentiate it from an ischemic ulcer as well.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes,
so yes, to sir. Differentiate it, so these are the two important situations. What form of therapeutic maneuver you would undertake, and to differentiate it from an ischemic ulcer, you have to certainly examine the lower pulses as well. Okay. Then yes, go sir. On. Systemic examination. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Go on.
The systemic examination, sir, abdomen is soft. There was no lump palpable anywhere in the abdomen, and abdomen was non-tender. Chest was bilateral vesicular breath sound. S1 and S2 audible. That is the heart sound.
Okay.
ENS, no abnormally detected. Sir, this is the system.
Summarize the case. Summary of the case.
Sir, a 63-year-old male with no comorbidities, shopkeeper by profession, presented with swelling and dull aching pain along the great saphenous vein and blackish pigmentation around the medial malleolus of the left lower limb. The pain and swelling worsens during the end of the day and relieves on lying down. On examination, there is varicosity affecting the great saphenous vein of the left lower limb. Trendelenburg test is ++, which indicates incompetence of saphenofemoral junction and perforators. Multiple tourniquet test reveals incompetent below knee perforators. Fagan's test is positive, showing the incompetent perforator site. arterial pulses in both wall limb is normal. No abnormality detected in the systemic examination. And sir, coming to the diagnosis, a 63-year-old gentleman, shopkeeper by profession, with symptomatic varicose vein of left lower limb involving great saphenous vein, complicated by skin pigmentation. The etiology appears probably reflux from saphenohumeral junction and Bellonii perforated. If I go by CEP classification, it is C4A, EP, ASP, and TR.
Dr. Soumen, come back to your examination
slide. Coming on to the etiology, what you have said that this is, what is the etiology? Incompetence at the saphenohumeral junction, or you would say that this is primary, this is secondary, or this is congenital?
Sir, this is primary, sir.
Primary. So what do you, primary? So this is primary varicosity. Okay. This is primary varicosity. You have said not congenital. Okay. So what are the manifestations in a case of congenital varicosity? Can you give one example of it? Congenital varicosity.
Congenital
etiology.
Absence of.
Have you heard the name of Klippel-Trenaunay syndrome?
Yes, sir. Klippel-Trenaunay syndrome.
What is that? What is that? Hello?
Sir, I haven't studied, sir.
Hello? Klippel-Trenaunay syndrome. Have you heard the name?
Yes, sir.
What is that? What are the characteristic findings in Klippel-Trenaunay syndrome? So, Klippel-Trenaunay syndrome, hello?
Gigantism, yes. Affected limbs, sir.
Gigantism, associated with gigantism. This is because of extensive arteriovenous malformations within the limb, which is congenitally determined. So, leading to local gigantism, as well as another important finding is patches of discoloration over different areas. What are those discolorations? That is port wine stains, multiple port wine stains over the different parts of the body. Okay, so this is, but you have said that this is primary. What do you understand by the primary etiology? What is your understanding?
Sir, primary idiopathic. Hello.
Primary. What is the pathology of primary? What do you understand by the primary? That is,
predisposing factor, sir.
So how is the primary varicosity explained? That there might be some congenital weaknesses of the superficial varicosities in its wall or in its valves. Okay.
Okay,
but without having any definite secondary factor involving the deep system. So primarily, whatever is it, it is in the superficial venous system, something in the form of weakness of the muscles or inappropriate valves, something like that, absence of valves, inappropriate valves, weakness of the muscles of the superficial venous system. That can be explained by the primary, by the term primary. And if you say that this is secondary, what do you understand? What do you mean by that? And what are the causes of secondary etiology?
Secondary varicose vein occurs due to any obstruction in the deep venous system, sir.
Obstruction. Only obstruction. Anything else? Obstruction. So, yes, you go on. Or inappropriate valves in the deep venous system. Inappropriately functioning valves in the deep venous system, or obstruction either within the lumen of the vein or because of some external pressure, say over the common iliac vein, something like that. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Have you heard the term? Have you calf muscle pump failure? What do you understand by that? Calf muscle pump failure.
Sir, the venous return from lower limb against the gravity towards the heart, it largely depends upon the pumping of the calf muscles. The there is in the calf muscles in within the soleus and gastrocnemius muscles, there is extensive venous network which compresses when we use the calf muscles, and it helps in the propagation of blood towards the vein. So if the calf muscle cannot,
if the calf pump, muscles yes
cannot pump the blood, so there is the venous return into the,
that is local stasis.
There is local stasis, sir, and the blood cannot.
That means the diastolic volume within the calf muscles, within the calf sinusoids, that is greatly increased. That is, so there is local stasis increasing the pressure within the deep veins. So that is the calf muscle pump failure. Okay.
Yes, sir.
And so can the varicocity can also develop because of arteriovenous fistulae in the extremities, say in the lower limb.
Yes, sir. Varicocity can also be a result of abnormal arteriovenous malformations.
Or fistulae, acquired arteriovenous fistulae. Acquired, say post-traumatic acquired arteriovenous fistulae. Okay. So these are the various secondary phenomenon that can lead to the development of varicosity in the lower level, secondary. So it can be congenital, it can be primary, it can be secondary. Now, a simple understanding. Can you tell me what is the physiology of blood flow in the lower extremity? How does it happen in simple words? Physiology of blood, venous blood flow in the lower extremity.
Sir, veins in the lower limb can be divided into three groups. Superficial group, and the perforator veins, and the deep veins, sir. The blood from the superficial area of the skin that drains into the superficial veins, and through the perforator veins, the blood goes from superficial to deep veins, and from
how does it occur? How does it occur? You have to explain this part. How does it occur?
Sir, the perforator
means when the patient is working the calf muscle. Yes.
Calf muscle. The perforator veins lies so within the substance of the muscle.
So soleus muscle is contracting.
Yes, sir.
Yes. So and, it is ejecting blood into the deep veins. Yes. Deep veins, the pressure is high, and without an edge. Yes. Now, firstly, explain the normal physiology. Sir, yes, the patient is working. The calf muscle has. Yes.
In normal situation.
So the blood in the calf sinusoids entered.
Hello. Yes, sir.
Hello. Can you hear me? Yes.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
The
perforator veins are pulsed, so the blood only flows. The blood only flows from superficial to deep
in normal situation. Just listen.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Just listen. So when the calf muscles are contracting, when the patient is walking. Patient, the calf muscles are now taut, gastrocnemius and soleus. So the because of this, blood becomes ejected from the calf muscle sinusoids into the deep venous system or the main deep veins in the extremity. The pressure becomes high. So the in only direction it can flow is towards the heart because the valves only can open in the upward direction. So blood goes up. But not in the lower direction, because if blood wants to go towards the lower direction, the valves will close. So the only one direction blood can go up is towards the direction of the heart. Next, yes, now the calf muscles are relaxed. The next phase, the calf muscles are relaxed because before the initiation of the next step. So now the pressure within the calf sinusoids is negative. So as soon as the negative pressure develops, again the blood that has minted up will try to come down towards the calf sinusoids. But again, it cannot come down because of the already closed valves, because of the regurgitating blood, if it at all tries to come back. So the only way the negative pressure would be minimized, that blood will flow from the superficial vein to reach into the carp sinusoids. So this phenomenon goes on. So this is the normal physiology.
When you examine the patient, you should keep in mind that the veins has got a anatomy in the leg. So you have a surface marking of the great saphenous vein. You have surface marking the short saphenous vein, and you will find there are some of the tributaries of the vein. It is very unlikely that you have only one straight vein.
Yes, sir.
Which is varicose. We find that apart from the main trunk, there is some varicosity of the side veins, which are either the tributaries or the communicating veins. And you started describing a large venous trunk is visible on the medial side of the leg. Instead of this statement, if you know the surface of the great saphenous vein, you can start saying the great saphenous vein on the right side appears varicose, extending from this part of the foot up to the thigh. Apart from this, there are some other tributaries which are also found varicose. Particularly in the leg, you'll find a vein runs parallel to the great saphenous trunk, which may mimic the great saphenous vein, that is called as posterior arch vein. So you should describe properly. You are not showing us the picture, I cannot make out, but you should keep in mind that this is a clear description of the main trunk. You should look at the short saphenous, also you should comment that short saphenous system of vein does not appear to be varicose. So that is the first observation on your examination. Next slide. Next. In palpation also, again, you don't just start with Brody Tenenbaum test. In palpation also, you should start with temperature of the limb, because you have said that patient has got congenital adrenal malformation, adrenal fistula. In that case, the limb may appear warm. And if the patient has got associated thrombophlebitis, there may be tenderness in the legs. So first start with temperature and tenderness. And then you said in Tenenbaum test, both these are incompetent. And in summary, you said the Brody Tenenbaum test is positive. How you have done this test? What is the method to do the test and say the test is positive? How you have done the Brody Tenenbaum test?
Yes, sir. First, I will ask the patient to lie down. And I will elevate the heel part of the limb, lower part of the leg, and I will milk the superficial veins so that they become empty. And I will mark the saphenofemoral junction beforehand. And after making the superficial veins empty, in the first component, I will tie a tourniquet just below the saphenofemoral junction. And ask the patient to stand up, and I will release the tourniquet quickly. If there is rapid feeding of blood from above, it shows there is incompetence of the saphenofemoral valve junction. And the for perforator, to see the perforator incompetence, I will in the same way I will make the superficial veins empty. And tie a tourniquet just below the saphenofemoral junction, and ask the patient to stand up, and keep the tourniquet for 3 to 5 minutes. If there is slow feeling of veins from below,
अरे यार नंगा बैठा हूँ मैं बहन चोद.
Yes, carry on.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
If there is a slow feeling of veins from below, it shows there is incompetence of the perforator, any of the perforator.
Okay, Shoman, you are right in saying this test being done in 2 steps. Otherwise, you can do the same test in 1 go. However, you have tried the tourniquet, ask the patient to stand up and wait. If you find the veins are filling from below, the test is positive. And once you find the veins are filled up, you release the tourniquet. If you find there is further filling from above, You say the test is positive, positive. That is the idea of saying, you said test is positive, positive. That is how you do the test in one go. You have said practice test is not done. Why you have not done is a clinical test. Why you avoided doing the practice test in this patient? And most of you said there's a modified practice test, not practice. Why you said you have not done?
Sir, practice test is very painful for the patient. That's why I am not done.
No, it's not at all painful. No. Who said it's painful? Unless patient has got, I said, thrombophlebitis and you find the vein is tender, it's not a tender test. How it is done? How is modified practice test done? Tell me the steps.
Sir, for modified practice test, sir, modified practice test is sir, not that painful. Sir, practice test is painful.
No, that's what I say. You are not doing practice test by carrying a tunicate along the whole leg. It's modified practice test. How do you do this? How do you do it? What is the method for doing a modified practice test?
Sir, I will tie a...
The veins are not empty. Okay, keep in mind.
No, no, sir. The veins are not
empty.
You
will not empty the vein. Patient is standing, the veins are full. You tie
I will tie a tunicate below just below the sternofemoral junction and ask the patient to walk quickly.
Yes. Brief wash quickly for 3 to 5 minutes. We come back. What do you observe now?
Sir, if the veins, if that as there is no reflux from above from the sternofemoral junction, if the veins become empty, so I can conclude that there is no obstruction, no pathology in the perforator or deep veins.
No, no, perforator, no. Perforator intention may be there. There is no evidence of deep vein thrombosis. The inference is if the vein has collapsed, there is exclusion of deep vein thrombosis. That is the test being done for. Okay. Perforator incompletion may be there. There is an explanation for that also. How do you explain? You have said that the perforator is incompetent. In spite of perforator incompetence, if the deep veins are patent on walking, the vein may collapse. What is the explanation? That is discussed by Dr. Bhakchaj just a few minutes back. You understand my question? In spite of perforator incompetence, yes, sir, yes. You ask the patient to walk. If the deep veins are patent, the vein will collapse. Why?
Sir, as the patient is walking, the perforator veins will propel the blood from superficial to deep veins.
Why?
Which?
Why?
And
because you have perforator incompetence, the blood should come opposite.
No, sir.
Why blood is going from superficial to deep veins? The answer is, just listen to me. The answer is, when the patient starts walking, the soleus pump starts pushing. That raises the deep venous pressure. And the deep venous pressure may go as high as 100 to 200 mmHg. So, with walking, because of soleus muscle pump action, the deep venous pressure is very high. That pushes the blood towards the heart. And in spite of perforator incompetence, now the blood from the superficial vein goes to the deep veins and that is directed toward the heart. So in spite of perforator incompetence, the blood flow in the perforator is now superficial deep because of soleus muscle pump action. So don't say perforator is not done. You have to do this unless the patient has got actual thrombophlebitis. Next. Next, next. Come to the diagnosis. Come to the diagnosis. In diagnosis, it says C4A. Okay.
Yes,
sir. There is another subscript. It should be S symptomatic, yes, or asymptomatic. Okay. So this patient has got symptoms. So in that case, it should be C4AS. Okay. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Otherwise, you have done the correct diagnosis. And you should mention this that there is no clinical evidence of deep vein thrombosis. You have not mentioned that line because that is important. Is it important to ascertain whether the patient has got deep vein thrombosis or not?
Yes, sir.
Yes, because the management will vary.
Because the management.
Yeah. Okay, Dr. Bhakchaj, you can go to the management part. Dr. Bhakchaj, please. Management. Dr. Bhakchaj, you can now go for the management of this patient. You have to unmute.
So what investigations would you carry out for this patient? What do you think?
Sir,
what are the investigations meant for varicocities? Yes.
Sir,
hello.
I will do some tests to confirm my examination findings. That is a duplex scan of the lower limb of both arterial and venous system. And I will do some supportive tests such as USG of whole abdomen and
arterial. Some... Why arterial?
Sir, I have to rule out.
You have...
Sir, I have to rule out arterial pathology because if there is arterial disease, I cannot proceed for surgery.
No. You cannot write everything. Each invasion costs you a lot of money. If the patient does not have any features of arterial
insufficiency, and as well as time also.
If the patient does not have any evidence of intermittent claudication, you find all the pulses are normal, there is no justification asking for an arterial Doppler in this patient. No. Okay. So don't.
So what are the information he would get? What are the information he would get, or he would like to note down from Doppler study? From Doppler study. Duplex scan. Yes. What are the informations you would like to collect?
Sir, I will get the location of the incompetent perforator.
Before that, first important is what? The deep venous
thrombosis is present.
The most important part of this duplex scanning. So how do you assess the deep venous system in duplex study? When do you say the deep venous system is normal? When do you say there is evidence of deep vein thrombosis or deep veins are incompetent? How do you do that?
Sir, deep veins are normally compressible, sir.
Yes.
And if there is any thrombus in the deep vein and is causing obstruction of the flow in the deep vein, the compressibility of deep veins will be lost.
One is compressibility. Good. One. What else? There are so many things in deep veins to look for. One is deep vein compressibility. What happens in the deep venous flow with phases of respiration?
Sir, during inspiration, the pressure in the thorax becomes negative, which will propel the blood towards the heart.
So there is more flow during inspiration, and during expiration, there is dampening of flow. This is known as normal phasic variation pattern in the deep flow, in the deep venous flow. What may happen in deep vein thrombosis, or there is partial decanalization?
There will be reversal of flow, sir.
Not reversal. The phasic variation may be lost.
Okay, sir.
Phasic variation may be lost.
Sir.
Okay. And if you can apply the color Doppler in the venous flow, what do you look for?
Sir, the color mapping of the flow, venous flow.
If it is a thrombus vein, but there is no flow, you can have a dynamic mapping of the flow.
Yes, sir.
So this is about the deep veins. How do you assess the incompetent areas on this duplex study? What is exactly done? You have to have this concept.
Sir,
are doing the duplex study because now more and more surgeons are doing this study. So what do you do?
Sir, we can place the calf muscles.
Yes. And how do you place the probe? When you press the calf muscle, why do you place the probe?
Sir, over the perforator region, sir.
Yes. So if you're doing an SFJ assessment, you keep the probe on the SFJ. You squeeze the calf. What happens? What do you see?
Yes, sir. If I press the calf muscles, the blood will flow from superficial to deep vein.
So you hear a sound in the ear. If you have an audible signal, as you squeeze the calf, you hear an audible signal in your ear. Push.
Yes, sir.
And when you relax, what happens?
The if there is the valve is incompetent, the blood will flow back into the superficial veins. There will be
reversal. Normally, in a normal person, as you squeeze the calf, you hear a forward sound. Push. Yes. And once you relax, there will be no flow back. So there will be no sound. But if there is reflux, you hear a rumbling sound like a murmur. So once you relax the calf muscle squeeze, you hear a rumbling sound. So that is the audible signal. Apart from this, if you apply color coding, what do you see? As you squeeze, you find there is blue flow towards
blue signal, sir. Blue signal, and
once you relax,
the blood comes back. It will be
red signal. So that is how you assess the perforator in this duplex study. Your concept should be clear. First of all, you assess the deep venous system. We did not do a Doppler study to diagnose varicose vein because that is a clinical diagnosis. Varicose vein is seen on the surface. We need no investigation to say that this vein is dilated. Our idea to do a Doppler study is to exclude the deep vein of thrombosis, number one, and status of deep vein, and number two, assess the perforators. So you know the surface marking of the perforators. Place your Doppler probe there and try to assess the perforator. So that is the idea of a Doppler study. Okay.
And what about the saphenopopliteal junction? So what particular information should you collect from here if there is particularly varicocyte is in the region of the popliteal fossa or just below that area?
Sir, hello. If there is involvement of the short saphenous vein,
evaluating the saphenopopliteal area, yes.
If there is varicocyte involved in the short saphenous vein, I will examine the saphenopopliteal yes. area because it is that area where the soft saphenous vein drains into the popliteal vein.
What is the difference? The SFJ is a relatively constant termination.
Yes, sir.
But saphenopopliteal junction is not a constant
variable. It can drain.
It is highly variable. So we have to first find out by Doppler study. We have to first find out where is the short saphenous terminating. It is highly variable. 2 centimeter below the knee joint.
Below the knee to
5 centimeter above. Yes. So the difference in the SFJ to SPJ is SPJ termination is variable. But SFJ termination is relatively constant. So apart from Doppler study, any other study like to do? Any other investigation from these lower limb veins?
No, sir. What veins? Only Doppler is enough.
So if you have a good Doppler study, you need not do a venography nowadays. So you can localize the perforated incompetence. You can assess the deep venous system. So a deep venous venography is not required routinely. Okay.
Yes, sir. Yes,
so if you this diagnosis, having the deep vein being patent here, what is your plan for this patient? How are you going to manage this patient?
Yes.
Sir, I will go for open surgery, that is Trendelenburg operation, which is class ligation of the saphenofemoral junction. And
patient is very progressive. He knows that now there are more advanced treatment. He does not want that. How do you counsel him?
The gold patient standard
is that nowadays there are a lot of other type of surgery. I don't like to have open surgery. What do you do?
Sir, nowadays gold standard treatment is endothermal venous ablation.
So in PG examination, your answer should be this only. Okay. What you are doing is fine. But the modern treatment, the gold standard treatment now is endovenous treatment, not a open surgery like a Trendelenburg and sticking. Okay. So your answer should be, I'll plan for this. Whether you are doing or not, that is the next question of discussion. But for patient point of view, the ideal treatment for this type of patient should be a endovenous treatment. So what endovenous treatment you like to do in this patient? What are the different types of endovenous treatment?
Sir, there is radio frequency ablation.
Yes.
Endovenous laser ablation.
Yes.
And another option is non-tumescent USG guided foam therapy. Sir.
Yes, that is also endovenous treatment.
Yes, sir.
So endovenous treatment includes RFA, EVLT, and foam sclerotherapy. So discuss about radio frequency ablation. What is the principle of treatment in radio frequency ablation or laser ablation? What is the principle of treatment?
Yes, sir. The principle is we'll apply the thermal or laser energy with inside the venous endothelium, and it will cause venous wall protein to coagulate, and that will cause the occlusion of lumen of the superficial veins. We introduce the catheter by doing a small venotomy, phlebotomy in the calf region. And progress the catheter upwards, and the catheter tip will lie 2 to 3 centimeter distal to the saphenofemoral junction. In case of radio frequency, we attach the other end of the catheter to a radio frequency generator, and it delivers heat. Target temperature is 120 degrees Celsius.
What and else you need to do? You cannot fire the generator. Once you put the catheter and you are in the desired
I will apply USG guided tumescent anesthesia. Good. Around the brain. That.
What is tumescent anesthesia? What do you inject and why do you inject?
Sir, it is a mixture of 450 ml Ringer's lactate and 50 ml sir lignocaine adrenaline and 16 ml of sodium bicarbonate solution.
So that is a solution. And how do you apply this?
What is the purpose of giving this tumescent anesthesia? Yes.
Sir, it serves various purposes, sir. First of all, it causes hydrodissection of the structures from the
hydrodissection. No. It's not a hydrodissection. No. It is not a hydrodissection. Tumescent anesthesia is given.
And it compresses the vein so that the catheter lies in contact with the venous endothelium. And also it acts
number
as a local
one. Anesthesia. Yes, one.
When you apply such amount of thermal second energy, this can cause skin burn. This can cause burn in the adjacent fat tissue.
Skin.
So what you do on injecting this, you inject about 10 ml per centimeter
per of centimeter vein. Of vein, sir.
So once you inject, there is a distance between the skin and the vein. And that distance should be more than 1 centimeter. Second is this compresses the vein. So vein become empty. This causes less thermal injury. And this has got a local anesthetic effect. Earlier, this surgery was done under general anesthesia or regional. Now you can do under local anesthesia. And this tumescent anesthesia provides analgesia for a long time. This is a 0.1% local anesthetic, but it gives good analgesia. So this is the effect of tumescent anesthesia. Yes.
What are the complications out of it? What complications can you have out of it, if sir, at all?
Sir, intraop complication may include hemorrhage and bruise and thermal injury to the skin.
Hemorrhage.
Or nerves.
Hemorrhage is
not a thermal injury to the skin. Sir?
If you keep your catheter more close to the SMJ, what is going to happen?
Sir,
why is the catheter kept?
Yes. Can there be late complications occasionally can be skin tethering and tattooing. Can there be deep vein thrombosis?
Yes, sir. Deep vein thrombosis also is a risk.
Deep vein thrombosis, vein to pulmonary embolism, superficial vein thrombophlebitis, then skin burn, nerve injury.
Superficial thrombophlebitis, yes.
Okay, you have treated the main segment of the vein from SMJ to the cuff. How do you manage the additional varicosity that is present? If you are doing endovenous treatment, how do you manage the side varicosities and other additional varicosities? Because you are not treating this side varicosity to increase ablation.
Clustered varicosity.
Sir, branch varicosities may be treated by conventional phlebotomy by putting a stab in the region of the incompetent perforators.
That is not phlebotomy. That is phlebectomy.
Phlebectomy, sir. Phlebectomy.
This is phlebectomy. You can have very
small. Stab phlebectomy. Stab phlebectomy.
You can do phlebectomy. Yes. And what else?
There are also powered devices.
Powered like phlebectomy, do you know? Yes.
Like Trihex.
Hello.
And also by foam sclerotherapy.
Yes. So this small additional varicosity may be either removed by hook phlebectomy or you can do a foam sclerotherapy or conventional sclerotherapy. Okay, so you are trying to
now,
say...
Now, coming as a lead... Hello.
Yes, sir.
So, can you explain that lately sometimes there can be re-varicosities. Can you explain the causes of recurrence of varicosities after these procedures or even after open procedures done?
You have done the...
Recurrent varicosity, developing causes.
Sir, it can be due to neovascularization and
neovascularization. Okay, acha.
And if so, there may be an accessory satellite vein present. accessory saphenous vein can be present, which can be missed during the ligation procedure. So which can lead to varicocities later on.
Bifid system, bifid or trifid system. Okay.
Anatomical.
Bifid or trifid system. Okay. So that can be missed. That can be, yes. So it can also be due to pelvic vein regurgitation phenomenon occurring within the pelvic veins regurgitation. You can't prevent that. So that can be another reason, because from the pelvic vein to the lower part of the other veins in the thighs, there are communications. So regurgitations in the pelvic veins is another cause of this. So that also needs to be excluded by doing a preoperative duplex study. So if there are isolated recurrent varicosity, can you do something for that? Hello.
Isolated? Yes, sir.
Treatment for recurrent varicosity, which is a small segment of.
I want to know something about the foam sclerotherapy. My last question. Foam. I want to something hear from you regarding the foam sclerotherapy. To understand by foam sclerotherapy.
Yes, sir. Foam is made by mixing sclerosant with air, and after the foam is made, we can inject the foam into the small venules, and which will cause extensive reaction of the venous endothelium and fibrosis of the venous lumen.
What is the advantage of sclerotherapy over standard sclerotherapy?
A small amount of sclerosant is required, as we are mixing air.
Yes. And a wider area you can cover up.
With small amount of sclerosant.
Swamin, you wanted to do an open surgery in this patient. Tell us, what's your plan? If you are doing an open surgery for this patient of varicose vein having a incompetent SFJ, incompetent Bologna perforator, what are you going to do? What is your open surgery you plan for this patient?
Sir, I will go for Trendelenburg operation, which is the flash ligation of the saphenofemoral junction, of the saphenofemoral junction, and stripping of the great saphenous vein up to upper cuff.
What about the tributaries? There are three tributaries which come in the terminal part of the great saphenous vein. What about these tributaries? You have to individually ligate.
Name the tributaries. All the tributaries
as possible. Because if you are drawing very close, this may appear again very close afterwards. Okay? Why do you, earlier convention was to strip the whole vein up to the cuff and up to the ankle. Why you are not stripping the whole segment of vein? What is the...
In the calf region, the great saphenous vein lies in the close contact with the saphenous nerve. So there is increased injury to the, chance of injury to the saphenous nerve if we strip the whole segment of the vein. That's why we ligate only up to the upper cuff. Strip up to the upper cuff.
How to manage the distal perforator incompetences? You have medial incompetent.
In my patient, as there is only single incompetent perforator, I will do open phlebectomy. That is, put an incision over the incompetent perforator site, which will be located beforehand by a Doppler study. Yes. I will put an incision over the region and identify the vein and just...
It's not phlebectomy. It's a ligation.
Ligation.
For these perforators, you have to just ligate the perforator. The varicose vein will disappear in course of time.
Yes, sir. Okay. If there is multiple incompetent perforators in the calf region, I can do subfascial endoscopic perforator ligation surgery.
No, don't jump to that. That is a different scenario. You are doing a Trendelenburg and then you put a endoscope in the lower leg for this perforator. If you are doing open surgery, your surgery is Trendelenburg, upper end stripping, and additional ligation of the perforators. And if you have multiple side varicosities, hook phlebectomy. That is your open surgery. But if you are doing a endoscopic surgery, what is the principle of endoscopic surgery? Yes, that is the entity was popular, but not very popular with this. Treatment. What is ACPS.
So subfascial endoscopic parapatellar ligation.
What is that? How do you do that? How do you do a endoscopic surgery for varicose vein?
Sir, I will make a 10 mm port for camera in the calf region.
How? How far it will go? When you make the port, they are all open ports. This port will be made where? In the subcutaneous tissue or deep to the fascia?
Sir, deep to the fascia.
Deep to the fascia. So make a port deep to the fascia. Pass the telescope.
Sorry, sir.
And then you can infiltrate. You can pass carbon dioxide. And then how do you find the perforators?
Sir, I can see the through the telescope the perforators.
One is by surface marking. One is surface marking, and second by the localization by ultrasound. And then you make additional ports. By making additional port, you can find the perforators which appears in the deep fascia, and you can apply clip. That is subfascial endoscopic perforator surgery. Not very popular, but this is the principle of doing this surgery treatment. What are the complications of varicose vein? Why do you need to treat? What are the complications of varicose vein?
Yes, sir. Varicose vein can lead to sir skin changes like lipodermatosclerosis, atrophic blanche, and there may be calcification of the veins. There may be varicose venous ulcer over the medial malleolus region.
Yes.
There may be periosteitis of tibia, and there may be equinus deformity of the ankle joint.
And thrombophlebitis.
And superficial thrombophlebitis.
How do you explain formation of ulcer in patient having a varicose vein? How does ulcer occur?
Sir, it can be explained by fibrin cuff theory, sir.
What is the explanation for development of ulcer in patient who has got chronic venous insufficiency?
Yes, sir. As there is venous hypertension in the superficial veins, there will be inflammation in the venous wall, which will lead to leaky capillaries and RBCs, and fibrins will escape the lumen and it will form the fibrin cups around the venules, and these fibrin cups will hinder the arteriovenous exchange within the between the arterioles and venules, and due to the arteriovenous exchange cannot occur, there will be anoxic change to the tissues, and due to the anoxia, there will be tissue sloughing, and there will be ultimately formation of ulcer.
So the point against this theory is, if it is a hypoxia, the ulceration should have occurred in the more distal part of the foot, in the toes. So there is another explanation for development of the ulceration. What is that? Apart from fibrin cuff theory?
Sir, white cell trapping theory, sir.
What is that? What happens in normal circulation? In normal circulation, the formed elements are in the center of the vessel.
Yes, sir. There is marginalization of the white cells. Yes.
So there is stasis because of the reflux. And these cells now migrate to the periphery. Marginalization of leukocytes.
And there is proteolytic damage. Activation of the inflammatory mediators, and there is proteolytic damage of the tissue.
So we can have some feedback from our other participants. Any question from the participants? Dr. Maiti? Yes, traveling. Any question from the audience? The varicose vein is a very important long case in the examination, and a lot of things are there in the clinical examination. Although people will say that you have now Doppler, you can do anything with the Doppler, but for a PG examination, this is a case where you need to do the test properly. You have to explain the clinical test and do a good interpretation. And then plan the management. As I said, don't jump in saying that I will do a Tannenberg operation. You should say that I discuss with the patient. There are now newer options for treatment.
So, you also colleague, Boston, or Kaspar, or Kuman, or Kuman, or Kuman.
Yes, Dr. Acharji.
Hello.
Dr. Acharji, any comment? Dr. Maiti is with us. Dr. Maiti? Shukumar Maiti?
Hello.
Hello.
Hello, Professor Saha.
Yes, yes.
This is from Dr. Acharya. The student answered quite well. He is he has prepared it well, I thought.
Yeah.
One thing just for him to listen, he has always been saying that I'll do this, I could do that. He is supposed to have done all this history taking as the examination, clinical examination.
Yeah.
He is presenting the case. So in examination, he should say that I have done the examination this way, or I have taken the history like this.
Yes,
so
yes.
This is one point, I think, to be pointed to.
Yes, yes.
Yes, sir.
Dr. Basak, any comment? Dr. S. Basak? I will be expecting questions from the participants. You may have some doubts. We can have these questions and we can answer those doubts also. Because these are the clinical examination where how far you should go. He said he has gone down the practice tests. In the end exam or any exam, if the patient has got any pain or he has some discomfort while eliciting some tests, you can avoid those tests. So he has got pain in the leg. He has got ulcer. In that case, he doesn't want to walk. So don't make him walk. So in that case, you skip the test. But the test which can be done without having any discomfort or harming the patient, you can do these tests. Our patients are very good. Dr. Basak, would you like to add anything? Dr. Basak? Okay, Dr. Soumen, you have done well.
Yes, sir.
Very good.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Good presentation.
Thank you.
Thank you. We end this class today. Thank you. We meet on Thursday. Thank
you. Question. What are the indications for
SAPS? You see, the SAPS, in SAPS, you don't strip the